We have been discussing the development of certain descriptors of random processes which help us to model failures of randomly vibrating systems. So, in this lecture we will be discussing more on envelope and phase processes associated with a given random process. Before that we will quickly recall what we have been doing. We have solved this problem of characterizing the number of times the level alpha is crossed in 0 to t by a random process x of t, and this is a counter that we set up, and this lower case n of alpha comma t gives a rate of crossing of level alpha. And when x of t is a Gaussian random process, we have been able to characterize the some of the lower order moments of these rates. We also asked the question on number of peaks above a given level alpha, and again we set up a counter and were able to characterize its properties for Gaussian random processes. Based on certain heuristic assumptions, we also derived the probability density functions of peaks for both narrow banded and broad band processes, and this was the expression that we obtained. Here epsilon is a bandwidth parameter that helps us to characterize whether the process is narrow banded, broad banded or somewhere in between. We also characterize the so called fractional occupation time, that is the fraction of time that a random process spends above a level alpha in a given duration 0 to capital T, and we were able to derive its expected value for a Gaussian random process. I also talked briefly about the notion of envelope and phase processes during the last lecture. So, we considered, for example, an undamped free vibration of a single degree freedom system, and the equation of motion is x double dot plus omega square x equal to 0, and if system starts from initial conditions x naught and x naught dot, we can write the solution as x of t is r cos omega t minus theta, where r is the amplitude of x of t and which is a function of the initial conditions and the natural frequency of the system. Similarly, the phase angle theta is a function of initial conditions and the natural frequency, and this r has the property that it is greater than or equal to modulus of x of t for all t, and this is called the envelope of x of t in this case. Similarly, for a damped free vibration problem, we could show that the response can be written as e raised to minus eta omega t r cos omega dt minus theta, where r is again described in terms of system natural frequency, damping and initial conditions, and the quantity r into e raised to minus eta omega t can be thought of as the envelope for this response. Now, if the same system is driven harmonically, again we can show that the response in steady state can be written as xst, which is a static response, into a dynamic magnification factor into cos omega dt minus theta, and this quantity x of st into dmf can be thought of as the envelope of response for this system. And similarly, theta is the phase angle for this system, and it is dependent on system natural frequency, damping and the driving frequency. Now, what happens if the system is now driven by an arbitrary force f of t? Can we get an envelope representation for the response in this case? So, we will start with the case where the system starts from rest, that initial displacement is 0, initial velocity is 0, and we assume that system is underdamped. So, the complete solution of this equation is given by the Duhamel integral 0 to t h of t minus tau into f of tau d tau, and the h of t minus tau is given by the first two terms here, and f of tau is the excitation. Now, what we could do is we can expand this sin omega dt, this term, and write it as sin omega dt cos omega d tau minus cos omega dt sin omega d tau f of tau d tau. Now, the integration is with respect to tau, therefore, terms involving time can be pulled out of this, and I can write this integral as a of t into sin omega dt plus b of t into cos omega dt. where a of t and b of t are these integrals. A of t is the 0 to t 1 by omega d e raised to minus eta omega t into cos omega d tau d tau f of tau d tau, and similarly b of t is given by this. So from this expression we can proceed further and write x of t as r of t cos omega d t minus theta of t. Here a of t, that is that integral just now I showed, is written as r of t into cos theta of t, and b of t is written as r of t sin theta of t. So r is square root of a square plus b square, and theta is tan inverse b by a. So that would mean even in this case we can write the response in terms of an envelope r of t and a phase theta of t. So this kind of representations are quite useful in characterizing the dynamic response, and question would naturally arise how to use such descriptions in characterizing random processes. An alternative interpretation for the envelope can be obtained by considering r square of t as x square of t plus x dot square of t divided by omega d square. So this damped natural frequency can be approximated by the undamped natural frequency, and we can write for omega n square k by m, and you can rewrite this as 2 by k into kx square by 2 plus mx dot square by 2. Therefore r square of t can be taken to be proportional to the total energy, which is sum of kinetic energy plus potential energy. Now whenever x dot is 0 or whenever x is maximum, r of t passes through the maximum values of x of t. That is, r of t is x of t whenever x dot of t is 0. The condition x dot of t equal to 0 is the condition for x of t to reach its extreme values. So that would mean r of t passes through extrema of x of t. If x of t is a sample of a narrow band process, r of t passes through all the peaks. So we can expect that, since we have already studied peaks, you could expect that properties of an envelope and properties of peaks in some sense would be similar, but that has to be actually verified. In fact, when we characterize the probability density function of peaks, we had used a heuristic argument which was not mathematically rigorous, but we could obtain an expression for probability density function of peaks which could prove useful if it is acceptable. But during the course of the following discussion we will show that by following a more rigorous approach we can show that r of t indeed shares some of the properties of the PDF of peaks that we obtained heuristically. To clarify the notion of an envelope further, we can consider a signal x of t is a into 1 plus epsilon cos omega m of t into cos omega t. The blue line that you see here is actually this function x of t. Now if you look at the multiplier a into 1 plus epsilon cos omega m t, that is shown in the red line here. This is the actually the envelope. This is e naught of t is a into 1 plus epsilon cos omega m t, which multiplies cos omega t, and this line is minus of that. So there are a pair of curves which actually bound the function x of t. This green line shows only this component e of t, which is a epsilon cos omega m t, okay, this part a into epsilon, that is a green line. So you can see that this is much slowly varying than the x of t itself, and it bounds x of t. Therefore if you are interested in highest values of x of t and so on and so forth, it may be much easier to study an envelope than the blue line, okay. So now we will pose this question: how do we generalize the notion of the envelope and phase to describe random processes? So again you see this is a sample of a narrow band process, so the envelope should pass through something qualitatively, should pass through all these peaks, and that is what intuitively we expect. But now we need to formalize this notion. If we look at the plot of x dot of t versus x of t, a narrow band process has this type of character. It does not fill up the entire space, it occupies you know certain space, you know, which is not diffuse. If x of t is a broadband process, it will simply fill up this space. So this is another you know feature that we need to bear in mind. Now to obtain a envelope representation for a random process, we will begin with x of t. Let it be a zero mean stationary Gaussian random process, and we will represent this random process in terms of a Fourier series as shown here. This we have discussed in one of the earlier lectures. I am recalling what we discussed. Here an and bn are random variables, and we can assume them to be normal distributed with zero mean and say standard deviation sigma n. An and bn are mutually independent and identically distributed. So that property is clarified here, and using these properties, if you want say mean of x of t, you take expected value of this. We know expected value of an is 0, expected value of bn is 0, therefore expected value of x of t is 0. Similarly, we can find the autocovariance, expected value of x of t into x of t plus tau, and we can show that that autocovariance is given by a function which is function of only tau. That would mean the process is a wide sense stationary random process. But since x of t is Gaussian, because an and bn are Gaussian and we are adding Gaussian random variables, x of t also would be Gaussian, and therefore x of t is a strong sense stationary process. Now I also shown in the previous lecture that if we now start with a power spectral density function made up of a set of Dirac delta functions, and if we compute the autocovariance of this, it has this form by using the Fourier transform, and if we compare this form with the autocovariance of the signal that we just now described, we can see that these two definitions will agree if sigma n square is chosen to be this. That means for the process that we described here, this process, the power spectral density function will be of this form. So if we are given a continuous power spectral density function like this, and if we discretize this into a few discrete frequencies, we can represent a Gaussian random process in terms of a Fourier series with random amplitudes. So that is the you know result that I will be using shortly. Now before I proceed, we can also notice that there is an alternative representation slightly different from the one that I described just now. So to clarify that, let us consider x of t to be a zero mean stationary random process defined as x of t n equal to 1 to infinity an cos omega n t minus theta n. Here these ans are deterministic constants, they are not random variables, okay. The only quantity that is random on the right hand side are these theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, etc. We assume that these theta n's are form an IID sequence of random variables with a common probability distribution function which is uniformly distributed in 0 to 2 pi. Now let us study the property of this random process. Suppose you are interested in mean of x of t, you have to take expectation of x of t, and to do that, if you expand this cos omega n t minus theta n using this identity, we can show that this expected value is given by this expression where the expectations of cos theta n and sin theta n need to be evaluated, and since theta n are uniformly distributed in 0 to 2 pi, these two integrals are 0. That would mean mean of x of t is 0. Now following the definition of autocovariance of x of t, we find now the expected value of x of t into x of t plus tau. So since an are deterministic and theta n are IID sequence, we can manipulate this expression and show that the autocovariance is indeed given by an square cos omega n tau summed from n equal to 1 to infinity. So this process also has a similar structure of autocovariance as we studied just where there was summation of an cos omega n t plus bn sin omega n t, where an and bn were random. Similarly, the Fourier transform of this, which will give the power spectral density, will also be a sequence of Dirac delta functions centered at omega n. So the two representations at the level of autocovariance and PSD yield the same results. So x of t in this case again is a wide sense stationary random process, and we can show that x of t is Gaussian because we are adding random variables which are identically distributed and which are independent, and we can expect that x of t would be Gaussian, and indeed that would be the case, and therefore even this process would be a strong sense stationary process. Okay, now based on these definitions of x of t, we can now introduce the notion of envelop and phase process for a random process. This definition follows the one that is proposed by Rice in 1940s. So we begin by using the Fourier representation x of t is n equal to 1 to infinity an cos omega n t plus bn sin omega n t, and an and bn are Gaussian random variables mutually independent, and omega naught is one of the basic frequencies that is a parameter in this model. We rewrite this terms cos omega n t sin omega n t as cos of omega n minus omega r t plus omega r t. Similarly, bn sin omega n minus omega r t plus omega r t, where omega r t, omega r is a central frequency. We will clarify the meaning of this in due course. Now I can now manipulate this expression. I can expand this cos of omega n minus omega r t plus omega r t using cos of a plus b the identity. So I rewrite this expression in this form. So the first term corresponds to this, and the second term corresponds to this. Now the summation is on n, therefore terms involving omega r can be pulled outside. So I can rewrite this as coefficient of cos omega rt is collected in one place, that is what is contained in this braces, and coefficient of sin omega rt is collected in one place. So the first term inside the brace I call it as ic of t, and the second term I call it as is of t, right, where ic of t and is of t are indeed these summations as depicted here. IC of t is again a Gaussian random process because an and bn are Gaussian, and IS of t by the same argument is also a Gaussian random process having zero mean, and you can show that they are stationary also. Now IC square of t, if you mean is zero, so therefore variance if you want to find, it is expected value of IC square of t, you can show that this is same as the variance of x square of t. Similarly, is of t is given by this, and based on this we can show that variance of is of t is again equal to x square of t. Now I now introduce this substitution, ic of t is a of t into cos theta of t, is of t is a of t into sin theta of t, where a square is ic square plus is square, and theta of t is tan inverse is by ic. Using these notations, now I am able to write x of t as a of t cos omega rt plus theta of t. A of t is the envelope process associated with x of t, theta of t is the phase process associated with x of t. A of t is square root of ic square plus is square, that would mean it is a non-linear transformation on two Gaussian random processes, so A of t would be non-Gaussian. Similarly, theta of t is a non-linear transformation on ratio of two Gaussian random processes, therefore theta of t also would be non-Gaussian. Omega r is a central frequency associated with x of t. So this is the envelope representation for a random process. We will quickly consider the alternative representation that we used, where x of t a was written as n equal to 1 to infinity a n cos omega n t minus theta n, where a n were deterministic. Here again, what I will do is I will rewrite this as cos of omega n minus omega r t minus theta n plus omega r t. Again expand, collect terms which multiply cos omega r t and sin omega r t, and I will be able to write this as EC of t into cos omega r t plus minus ES of t into sin omega r t. These are again two summations. EC of t is this summation, first term, and ES of t is the second summation. These are again stationary random processes having properties quite similar to that of x of t. Now, if I now introduce the notation, EC of t is a of t cos theta of t, and ES of t is a of t sin theta of t, I can write x of t as a of t into cos omega r t minus theta of t, where a of t is square root of EC square plus ES square, which is the envelope process. Theta of t is tan inverse ES of t divided by EC of t. This is a phase process. So, using the two alternative representations, we get a similar representation for the envelope. They may differ in some details, but in essentials, they are quite similar. Okay. The question now is, we have defined envelope and phase processes. They are non-Gaussian, even when x of t is Gaussian. So, we seem to be making the problem complicated. The notion of envelope and phase processes would be useful if we can determine their probability distributions. The basic idea is that envelope varies lot more slowly than the parent process. Therefore, describing a slowly varying function is easier than describing a rapidly varying function. So, that is a basic expectation, but that expectation would be met only if we are able to determine the requisite probability distribution functions of these two random processes. A random process is completely described in terms of its joint probability distribution and density functions, and unless we are able to say something useful about them, this notion of envelope and phase, which essentially introduces nonlinear transformation on the parent process, is likely to be not helpful. But fortunately, the problem of finding probability distribution of envelope and phase processes is solvable, especially when x of t is a Gaussian random process, and we will see later that this could be done even for a few non-Gaussian random processes. So, to see that, we will start with the following definition. We introduce two quantities a of t and b of t, which are random processes, and we define x of t as a of t cos omega t plus b of t sin omega t. And furthermore, we put a of t is r of t cos phi of t and b of t is r of t sin phi of t. So, x of t itself now can be written in the form of r of t cos omega t plus phi of t, where r of t is square root of a square plus b square and phi is tan inverse b by a. By definition, we say that R of t is the amplitude process envelope or amplitude modulation of x of t. They are all synonymous. Phi of t is also is called a phase process or phase modulation of x of t. Omega is known as a carrier frequency or a carrier frequency or central frequency. Now, what is the problem? Now, the problem is we started with definition of a and b. Suppose we are given the joint probability distribution function of the process a of t and b of t. Can we find the joint probability distribution function of r and phi, which is envelope and phase? So, we know a is r cos phi and b is r sin phi. This transformation of random variables can be handled using the rules of transformation of random variables. It is not very complicated. So, we find the Jacobian or its inverse, and we show that this is j to the power of minus 1 is 1 by j is r, and consequently we get P of R phi as R P A B A comma B with A and B evaluated at R cos phi and R sin phi. If A and B are jointly Gaussian, I can write the 2-dimensional probability density function in terms of standard deviation of A, standard deviation of B and correlation coefficient between A and B, and then that is of this form. We are taking that A and B have 0 mean. So now we can substitute this expression into this identity and try to get the probability density function between joint probability density function of R and phi, and if we do that we get this expression which is a joint probability density function between R and phi. If you want the marginal probability density function of R, you have to integrate the joint density function between R and phi with respect to phi. R takes values from 0 to infinity, phi takes values from 0 to 2 pi. Similarly, you want marginal density function of phase, this is 0 to infinity P R phi R comma phi dr, and phi varies from 0 to 2 pi. So the problem is in some sense at this level is solved. Indeed, for the this particular joint probability density function, we can evaluate these integrals and we can show that the envelope process, the first order probability density function, has this form and the phase process has this form. It is not uniformly distributed between 0 to 2 pi. In that sense, it is not that it is always characterless, it has some properties. Now this I naught is Bessel's function of the first kind, and this distribution we call it as a generalized Rayleigh distribution. So R is a generalized Rayleigh random variable and phi is a generalized beta random variable. This is a beta distribution. This I naught incidentally is the definition of I naught is displayed here. It is integral 0 to 2 pi exponential of b cos theta d theta is 2 pi I naught of b, where I naught of b is the modified Bessel's function of argument b and order 0. This is a tabulated function, so you can obtain the value of I naught of b with reasonable effort. We can now consider a special case where we can assume that a and b are uncorrelated and they are identically distributed with same standard deviation. In this case the joint density function is given by this, because here moment RAB becomes 0, some of these terms drop off and it is possible to simplify that and we get this expression. Now cos square plus cos square phi plus sin square phi is 1, therefore we really get an expression which is lot simpler than the case when RAB is not 0, and if we now find the marginal probability distribution function of R, we get a Rayleigh random variable, and if we find the marginal distribution of the phase angle, we find that the phase angle is uniformly distributed, and also we can show that the envelope and phase are statistically independent. So mind you, this is for this special case where A and B are uncorrelated and sigma A is equal to sigma B. The more general result has been obtained previously. As I said at the beginning of the lecture, envelope and peaks share common properties because envelope passes through all the maximum values of x of t, and therefore it is not surprising that for the envelope we obtained a Rayleigh probability distribution function, because the same result was obtained earlier by studying peaks and by using an heuristic argument valid for narrowband random processes. The heuristic approach based on which we derived the Rayleigh model for the peak distribution thus in a way stands justified, since using a more rigorous argument we have arrived at Rayleigh model for the envelope. In a way that the ad hoc assumptions that we made seem to be justified. Another important thing that we should notice is the first order probability distribution of amplitude and phase are independent of the choice of central frequency. Okay. we can ask slightly more involved questions. For example, can we find the joint probability distribution function of R of T1, R of T2, phi of T1 and phi of T2? That means R of T is a random process. Can we determine the second order probability characteristics, second order moments or second order probability density function? So to do that, we consider x of t at T1 in T2. So I get A of T1 cos omega T1 plus B of T1 sin omega T1 and so on and so forth. So the quantities A of T1, A of T2, B of T1 and B of T2 are related to R of T1, R of T2, phi of T1 and phi of T2 through these four equations. So we will consider this as A1, B1, A2, B2 and R1, phi1, R2, phi2 and we rewrite this in this form. And here again, this is a problem of transformation of random variables. We are considering these transformations at two time instants. There are four random variables transformed to produce four more random variables. So we can apply the rules of transformation. We need to evaluate the Jacobian, which is determinant of a 4 by 4 matrix. And in this case, it turns out that the sum of the intermediate steps are displayed here. 1 by j turns out to be R1 into R2. Therefore, now the joint density function between R1, R2, phi1, phi2 is obtained in terms of joint density of A1, B1, A2, B2 using this identity. R1, R2 is 1 by j and for A1, A2, B1, B2 we have to use these transformations. So from this, if I want now the joint density, second order probability density function of the envelope process, right, this can be obtained by finding the marginal density of this joint density. We need to integrate with respect to phi1 and phi2 over 0 to 2 pi. Actually, this strictly speaking, this has to be written as T1, T2 because R of T is a random process and we are considering two time instants. Now, if X of T is a Gaussian random process with 0 mean and A and B become Gaussian, in fact, this integration can be done and one can show that the second order probability density function is indeed given by this joint density function. This details can be worked out, that I leave it as a matter of an exercise for you to verify. So in any case, the basic result is that we are able to find out first order and second order probability density functions of envelope and phase processes. Although I have displayed here the result for the amplitude process, you can also get the second order probability density function of phase process also by a similar exercise where I integrate from 0 to infinity this quantity with respect to R1 and R2. Now, in our studies on level crossing and peaks, etc., we found that if X of T is a random process, the number of times the level alpha is crossed depends, if you want to characterize that, we need to get the joint probability density function between the process and its derivative. So that leads us to the question, if I am now interested in finding, for example, the number of times the envelope process crosses a level alpha, then I will need the joint probability density function between the envelope and its derivative at the same time instant. So it is a fairly complicated question. Mind you, A of T is a non-Gaussian random process. Now, however, the nature of transformations involved are not very complicated, therefore a solution to this could be obtained and that is what I will briefly outline. So I have A of T is R cos phi of T, B of T is R of T sin phi of T. From this, if I now evaluate A dot of T, it will be R dot cos phi minus R phi dot sin phi of T. And similarly, B dot will be R dot sin phi of T plus R of T phi dot cos phi of T. That means I am differentiating sin phi of T and I get these terms. So there are now four random variables which are transformed through a set of four nonlinear equations leading to four new random variables, and we can now do the address the problem of finding the joint probability density function of P R R dot phi phi dot. All of that evaluated at the same time instant t. this is doable. You have to now evaluate the Jacobian, which is 1 by j in this case, which is determinant of a 4 by 4 matrix, and we can go through this calculation. Initially it may look quite complicated, but you should notice that there are several zeros in this and the expansion of determinant is a lot more simple than what it appears at the first sight, and you can show that 1 by j is indeed r square. So I have shown some intermediate steps to assist you in verifying this. So we have this now, the formal solution, joint density of r, r dot phi phi dot evaluated at t is given in terms of r square, which is 1 by j, p of a a dot b b dot, where a b a dot b dot are related through these relations. So in principle I have obtained the 4 dimensional joint probability density function between r, r dot phi phi dot. Now if I want only r joint density function of r, r dot, I have to carry out a 2-fold integration with respect to phi and phi dot. These are tedious but doable, especially if certain simplifications are made on properties of a of t and b of t. Now if a of t and b of t are 0 mean Gaussian stationary random processes such that a square, expected value of a square, expected value of b square are equal, and that we have seen a while before that they are indeed equal for a random process x of t, and if we further assume that a of t, a dot of t, b of t and b dot of t are independent, and we impose the condition expected value of a dot square of t and b dot square of t is sigma 1 square, okay, which is not the variance of the velocity derivative process, it is something different. We can now consider, for example, if you take now x of t is a of t cos omega t plus b of t sin omega t, x dot of t I can write in this form, and we can actually evaluate x dot square of t, which I need here, as sigma x square is equal to sigma n square plus omega square sigma x square, where sigma 1 square is related to, you can show this, this is sigma 1 square, where in evaluating this you will see that a dot and b dot are sitting here, and that is why we get sigma 1 square here. Now I leave it as an exercise, fairly longish exercise, for you to verify that this fourth order joint density function is given by this. You have to verify whether these statements are true. The range of r is 0 to infinity, r dot is minus infinity to plus infinity, phi is 0 to 2 pi, phi dot is minus infinity to plus infinity. You can, after determining this, you could find the marginal density of r, r dot by integrating from 0 to 2 pi for phi and minus infinity to plus infinity for phi dot, and if you do this you get this non-Gaussian 2 dimensional probability density function. You could also determine the second order probability density function of phi phi dot evaluated at same time t. There is one research paper by Langley in 1986 which appeared in Journal of Sound and Vibration, where some of these issues are discussed in greater detail. So if you would like to solve this, address this exercise, attempt this exercise, I would encourage you to go through this paper. Now as I said at the beginning, if we know the joint density function between process and its time derivative at the same time instant, we can characterize the number of crossing of level alpha by the envelope process r of t. I mean we can characterize, in fact the average rate of crossing of level xi by the random process r of t, where the crossings are taken to be with positive slopes, is given by this expression, and we could use the result that we derived just now and show that the this rate is indeed given by this expression. Please notice that r of t is non-Gaussian. So this expression is not similar to what we got for a Gaussian random process, slightly different. Now one more thing that we should notice is when we are talking about crossing of level alpha by a random process x of t, if a process is narrow banded, the crossings tend to occur in clumps. What does that mean? Now you consider this blue line, which is, you can say that is a sample of a narrow band process, and suppose we are interested in crossing of this level alpha. Now you follow the crossing of this red line by the blue curve. Here there is one crossing, and you see that moment one crossing occurs, there are 4 crossings. After that there is a lull, you wait here for this time, and again there are crossings. Similarly here crossing is in a clump, so this is known as clumping. Whereas you look at the envelope here, this crossing, the next crossing with positive slope occurs here. That means the time between 2 crossings is well separated for the envelope process than for a narrow band process. Now what is the significance of this result? When we were modeling the number of times the level alpha is crossed by the process x of t, we proposed the use of a Poisson random variable. That counting process be modeled as a Poisson random process was our proposition. In Poisson model, we the events are taken to be independent. Now, the assumption of independence is more likely to be valid for an envelope than for the parent process, because for a parent process, moment this is crossed, then there are going to be several crossings. That would mean this crossing and this crossing are unlikely to be stochastically independent. There is an element of dependence because they occur in clumps. Whereas here for the envelope, there is no such restriction because the time spent between 2 successive crossings is longer, and therefore the assumption of independence is likely to be more acceptable here. Later on we will see that the implications of these features. To characterize this clumping effect, we define what is known as clump size, and that is the average clump size is defined as the ratio of rate of crossing of level xi with positive slopes by the parent process to the rate of crossing of the same level by the envelope process with positive slopes. And for the process that we have been studying, Gaussian random process, the expression for this is obtained as shown here. So as I said, the Poisson model for number of level crossings is more appropriate for R of t than for x of t. Now we now move to the description of random process by yet another criteria. We consider now the time required by x of t to reach a level alpha for the first time. So quickly let us recall, suppose this is x of t, the blue line is x of t, this is x of t, and the red line is the level alpha. For this trajectory, the time required for x of t to cross alpha for the first time is shown by this pink line. For the next realization, this crossing occurs fairly early and the time required for first occurrence of crossing is much less, whereas here it takes quite a long time. Or in other words, for every sample realization, if you observe the time required for first crossing of level alpha, you will see that those observations can be interpreted as outcome of a random experiment, and therefore that itself is a random variable. So the problem is, therefore we introduce that as TF of alpha, that is time required for crossing of level alpha for the first time. It is a real valued random variable taking values in 0 to infinity. Now the question is, given the complete description of x of t, can we characterize this random variable? Can we obtain its probability distribution function or its moments, or what we can do about it? This problem is known as the problem of first passage problem, barrier crossing problem, or outcrossing problem. These are all synonymous. And this is a very important problem in the study of reliability of dynamical systems, because this time for first passage can be interpreted as a lifetime of the system, okay. So the level alpha could be the crossing of some prescribed stress metric at a given point, and if that stress level is crossed, we define that as failure. So how much time the structure takes to cross that level for the first time, so that tells us what is the lifetime of the structure. Now we use now Poisson model for this number of crossing of level alpha by 0 to t, this we have seen earlier. So x of t is a random process and alpha is a level, and we assume that the threshold level alpha is high so that the crossing is a rare event, and crossing times are mutually independent, and under these assumptions we showed that we can use the model that n of alpha comma 0 comma t is a Poisson random variable with this probability distribution function. The parameter lambda here is the rate of crossing of level alpha, and for a random process this we have already determined to be n of expected value of n of alpha comma t, and we have derived this for Gaussian random process and also for the Anolab process. If x of t is a stationary Gaussian random process with 0 mean, we have shown that this is the expression for this rate parameter lambda. So the probability distribution function for the number of times the level alpha is crossed, that is probability that n equal to k, is given by this expression, essentially the Poisson model with alpha lambda, the parameter lambda given in terms of expected value of n of alpha comma t. Now what is its relation to the problem of first passage times? Now if you look at probability of first passage time being greater than or equal to t, this probability is same as the probability that there are no crossings of level alpha in 0 to t, or in other words probability that crossings with positive slopes of level alpha is actually equal to 0. If the first passage time is greater than t, this should be equal to 0. Now we have now postulated a model for it, and this is what we get in terms of rate of crossing of level, average rate of crossing of level alpha. From this now we can get the probability distribution function, which is 1 minus p of t f of alpha greater than or equal to t. Now mind you that this lowercase t which appears here is actually the state variable. Now t f is a random variable, t is a state variable, and this is a distribution function which is given here. If you want the probability density function, you have to differentiate that with respect to t, this lowercase t, and we get this as the model for the probability density function for the first passage time. So what are the parameters involved here? The level alpha, the variance of the parent process, the variance of the derivative process, and of course the time t, which is the state. This is actually nothing, this density function actually corresponds to the probability density function of an exponential random variable. So probability distribution function is 1 minus e exponential minus lambda t, and probability density function is lambda into exponential minus lambda t, where lambda is this rate. So the expression just now I showed, this expression is essentially this written with lambda in this, in these places. So tf under these hypotheses, that is using Poisson model for level crossings, we get exponential model for the first passage time. We could of course evaluate moments of this first passage time, its variance and so on and so forth. For example, the expected value of first passage time can be shown to be given by 1 by lambda. Now what happens if x of t is a non-stationary 0 mean Gaussian random process? So let us consider that, let x of t be a non-stationary 0 mean Gaussian random process with autocovariance rxx of t1 comma t2. Now, we have solved this problem, how to find the average rate of crossing of level alpha by the process x of t. This is a problem that we have considered before, and we got this is the expression that we need to solve, and we have shown that this rate is given by this fairly complicated formula. The parameters σx, σx dot and r, which is the correlation coefficient, are all now time varying. Okay, so this rate itself is time varying because process is non-stationary. Now, how do I find the first probability distribution function of the first passage time here? We had 1 minus exponential of minus lambda t, where lambda was a constant. Now, we have to replace it by an integral. It is 1 minus exponential 0 to t, this rate into d tau. Okay, so this is fairly involved because parameters inside that are present in the expression for nx plus are functions of time, which characterize the non-stationary trend of the random process x of t, and that need to be evaluated. I mean, that integration has to be performed over time to evaluate this probability distribution function. So obviously, this is doable, but it is more complicated than the case of a stationary random process. So the problem of first passage time therefore can be tackled if you can characterize a level crossing problem. So when we started talking about level crossing problem, this connection to first passage time was not very obvious, but if you now trace back the arguments that we have used, we started with level crossing problem, and for high levels of crossings we use Poisson model, and based on Poisson model now we are able to solve the problem of first passage times. Now, one of the assumptions that we made, as I mentioned, this is an important assumption, that is, crossing times are mutually independent. Now, we noticed when I discussed about clumping effects in narrowband random processes, the assumption that crossing times are mutually independent is unlikely to be valid for a narrowband process because of this occurrence of clumps. But on the other hand, for the same process, the envelope process can be thought of as, this assumption of crossing times being mutually independent is likely to be more valid for the envelope process, because the time difference between crossings are longer and more random for envelope process. So based on that, we could look at first passage time for envelope process R of t. So we have actually derived this rate for a specific case. In general, since we know the expression for the joint density between the envelope and its time derivative, in principle this rate can be evaluated, but for under certain simplified assumptions we have shown that this rate is given by this. Therefore, the first passage time of this non-Gaussian random process, right, this is a fairly complicated question, has been tackled, and we get this model for first passage times. This is much likely to be much more realistic than the previous model that we obtained here. Now, in the next lecture, I will be considering the most important descriptor, namely the maximum value of a random process in a given time interval 0 to t. This is what primarily we are interested in as engineers. Suppose we are considering time duration of say 0 to 1 second, and we are interested in the highest value of x of t. This black dot shows that number for this realization. This is for the second realization, and this is for the third realization. Clearly, for different realization of x of t, this highest value can be thought of as an outcome of a random experiment. Therefore, it is a random variable itself, and it is a continuous random variable. So the problem is, given the complete description of x of t, what is the probability distribution function of this extreme value? I will show in the next lecture that the solution to this problem is again intimately connected to the problem of level crossings, Poisson model for level crossings for high levels, and the solution of first passage problem. All these are interlinked, and this is what we will consider in the next lecture, and we will conclude this lecture at this stage.